Good evening and welcome to Digging Deeper, moment number 214. The purpose of our Digging Deeper moments is to take God's Word to God's world, and we're so glad that you've joined us. If you would, please take a moment to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you. We've been looking at the seven Jewish feasts as they appear in the New Testament. So far, we've looked at the Feast of Passover, we've looked at the Feast of Pentecost, and we've looked at the Feast of Unleavened Bread, because these are the most obvious in the New Testament. Now, looking at these three feasts, however, we only briefly mention the offering of the sheaf of first fruits. And as we've seen, the Feast of Passover, it took place on the 14th of Nisan. That's our March-April. The Feast of Unleavened Bread began on the 15th of Nisan. And on the 16th of Nisan, they offered a sheaf of the barley as first fruits of the grain harvest. Then they counted 49 days. On the 50th day, they celebrated Pentecost. Tonight, we want to go back to the offering of the sheaf of barley on the 16th of Nisan to see its significance in the New Testament. The sheaf of barley was offered as a wave offering, which meant that it was offered to God, and then it was brought back so that the priests could use it in their temple rituals. But the idea of it being first fruits was that it represented the whole harvest of barley. Leviticus chapter 23, verse 14 says, "You shall eat neither bread, nor parched grain, nor fresh grain until the same day that you have brought an offering to your God. It shall be a statute forever throughout all your dwellings." The offering of the first fruits signified the rest of the harvest that would come in. The word first fruits is used 8 times in the New Testament, and twice it's specifically used of Christ. The other 6 times, the word means a part which represents the whole. We find it in Romans chapter 8, 23, which tells us that we've been given the first fruits of the Holy Spirit. We find it in Romans 11, 16, which reveals that Israel is the first fruits of the people of God. We see it in Romans chapter 16, verse 5, when Paul speaks of the first fruits of his ministry in Greece. In 1 Corinthians 16, 15, Paul speaks again of his first fruits of his ministry in Greece, also known in a certain part of Greece called Achaia. James chapter 1, verse 18, James speaks of the early Christians as a kind of first fruits of creation. And again in Revelation 14, 4, it speaks of certain believers being the first fruits of God and the Lamb. Now, the other 2 times that the word first fruits is used, they both speak of Jesus Christ. The first is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep." 1 Corinthians 15, 23 goes on to say, "For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, and afterward those that are Christ that is coming." Jesus Christ is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, that is, those who've died. In other words, Jesus' resurrection is the first of the entire harvest of humanity. The full harvest is the resurrection of the dead, which will take place at his second coming. This is the reason many believe that Jesus' resurrection took place on the 16th of Nisan, the very day that the sheaf of the first fruits of barley was being offered in the temple. Whether this is so or not, we'll discuss in a later Digging Deeper series coming this year. But either way, the offering of the sheaf of barley on the 16th of Nisan pointed to the resurrection of Christ as the first fruits of the dead. Think about it. On the 14th, the Passover, whose blood delivered Israel from death at the hands of the death angel, it was sacrificed. Jesus is our Passover lamb. Then on the 15th, Israel began a 7-day feast called Unleavened Bread. And on the 15th day, they also left Egypt and they were freed from bondage. And that's what this feast represents. So likewise, Christ freed us from the bondage of sin. Then on the 16th of Nisan, the sheaf of first fruits was offered, which pointed to the entire harvest. Jesus rose from the dead and was the first fruits of the resurrection. His resurrection points to ours. John chapter 5, verse 28 records the words of Jesus when he says, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice," and that's the voice of the Son of God, that's him, "and come forth, and those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation." In John 6, 44, Jesus goes on to say that this will happen on the last day when he says, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day." 3 times in chapter 6, Jesus says that he will raise us up on the last day. So when will we be resurrected? On the last day. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 14 says something similar when it says, "For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus." And 1 Corinthians 15:22 through 23 confirms this very point when it says, "For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterward those who are Christ at his coming." This is God's program. First, Christ arose on Easter Sunday. Then we will rise at Jesus' second coming. Why? Jesus Christ, his resurrection, is the first fruits. It represents the whole. The Apostle John put it quite a little bit differently in Revelation chapter 1:5 when he calls Jesus the firstborn from the dead. And he writes, "And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood." So we've seen that an understanding of the Feast of Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, and Pentecost helps us understand the messages of the New Testament. But we're out of time, and there are three more festivals, feasts to go, and we'll begin looking at them next week. If this lesson's helped you, please share it with a friend, like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, subscribe to our YouTube channel, or check out our Sunday Morning Live podcast on either Apple or Spotify. And hey, if you haven't yet subscribed to our YouTube channel, please do that. It will help us greatly. Thank you. I hope to see you next week.